to the same thy Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. And the angel of the Lord spake unto Philip, saying, Arise, and go toward the south, unto the way that goeth down from Jerusalem unto Gaza, which is desert. And he arose and went, and behold, a man of Ethiopia, an eunuch of great authority, under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who had the charge of all her treasure, and had come to Jerusalem for to worship, was returning, and sitting in his chariot, read Isaiah the prophet. Then the Spirit said unto Philip, Go near, and join thyself to this chariot. And Philip ran thither to him, and heard him read the prophet Isaiah, and said, Understandest thou what thou readest? And he said, How can I, except some man should guide me? And he desired Philip that he would come up and sit with him. The place of the scripture which he read was this. He was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and like a lamb dumb before his shearer, so opened he not his mouth. In his humiliation, his judgment was taken away. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
So shall ye be my disciples. The Gospel of the Lord.
Spring has finally sprung in this month of May, Mary's month, and just wanted to go over a few things. If you do wish to receive communion in both kinds, you may have noticed the tray at the back of the church there. I simply take a cup and come forward and receive the host in one hand, and then the subdeacons, who will be at either aisle, will have a cruet of consecrated wine from the tabernacle, and will put some in your cup. Please keep your mask on, and then go back to your pew and communicate yourself there, and then the cup goes in the basin at the back of the church at the end of the service. There are three special things coming up, two in May and one in June. The first one is the Feast of the Ascension, which will be on the 13th of May, a Thursday, as it is always every year. And we will have a solemn mass at 6:30 p.m. It will be both live streamed and in person. So please do join us if you can on the 13th, Thursday at 6:30 p.m. As well, on Sunday the 23rd, 10 days later, it is the Feast of Pentecost. The bishop will be here at both, I believe, 8 and 10, and he will be doing confirmations. I'll do one baptism, and he will do, I think, about 8 adult confirmations and receptions, and maybe up to 5 youth confirmations as well. So I'm really looking forward to that. And then finally, on June 6th, the first Sunday in June, is my last Sunday with you as the rector. And I will be celebrating 8 and 10 as usual. And then at 4 o'clock, we'll have a special Corpus Christi Evensong with the bishop present again. Hope to see you all there, either online or live, in person. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It should come as no surprise that Jesus' most decisive actions and teachings involve tree imagery. I mean, that's obvious, right? Don't know what I'm talking about? Well, maybe I should back up a little. This sentence, it should come as no surprise that Jesus' most decisive actions and teachings involve tree imagery, may be found on page 39 of a 46-page study guide that goes along with a 4.5-minute video about the tree of life in the Garden of Eden, as it relates thematically to who Jesus is and what he did and continues to do to this day. The video is by the Bible Project, and if you read my evangelist letter, you already know a little bit about it, and maybe even watched the video and skimmed the study guide before you came to church today. If not, that's fine. You can always do it later. The video itself is pretty straightforward. The script for it is only 4 pages long. In it, the two narrators, John and Tim, have a conversation. And I'm not going to specify who says what in every single instance in the following quotation. I might say, John, Tim, John, Tim. That would really be tiresome. I'm not going to require us to watch the video as a part of the sermon, tempting though it may be. I thought about employing sock puppets, Tim and John, but I thought maybe I'll save that for my last sermon here. The narrators begin, the story of the Bible begins in a garden, where God and humans live together. And the biblical authors want us to see this garden as a type of temple. The top is the most sacred place, the Holy of Holies, where God's presence is most intense. And that's where we find the tree of life. So what's the tree of life all about? John and Tim go on to tell us that the tree represents God's own life and creative power that is made available to others. In fact, God's first command is that humans eat from all the trees, including this one, and with the exception of one other. So at this point, John asks, so you're ingesting God's own life? That sounds intense. And Tim replies, yeah, this meal transforms the one who eats it. Or, in the words of the story, it leads to eternal life. Sounds pretty Eucharistic, doesn't it? Now, these guys are hipster, non-denominational evangelicals, basically Baptists with sharp haircuts and geeky glasses. And so I knew that they weren't really looking at it so Eucharistically as I would. I don't believe they believe that communion is the very body and blood of Christ, but they do believe that the story is about ingesting God's own life and becoming part of the one who eats it, leading to eternal life. So I think we have more in common than I thought at first. Now, as the story in the video continues, they recount how instead of eating from the tree of life, Adam and Eve, of course, eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. This tree, they say, represents taking the authority to do what is good in your own eyes. When humans do that, it leads to broken relationships, violence, and death. Tim elucidates. And so here's the thing. Both trees look beautiful, but one of them is a false tree of life. They go on to talk about the golden calf and how the history of humanity is the history of our choosing idols rather than God. Generation after generation, humans choose gods of their own making, not the God who made us. And then they make this really brilliant pivot that connects the Garden of Eden to what Jesus was talking about in the Gospel this morning. I am the vine, ye are the branches, and all that. One says, well, let's turn now to the story of Jesus. He came to announce that God's eternal life was available once again through him. And the other interjects, so Jesus thinks of himself as the tree of life? Yes, this is what he meant when he claimed to be the vine that brings God's life into the world. And Jesus invited people to eat from him. That is, Jesus invited people to trust him and be transformed by his life. But, they go on, Jesus also exposed how corrupt humans are, how much they love false trees of life. And so Jesus presented people with a new choice between life and death. And this time, they don't just choose death, they also choose to attack the one who sustains all of life to begin with. So Jesus is led up to the top of a hill, where he dies upon a tree. The cross is the sad and violent result of humanity's desire to do what is good in our own eyes. And that's where the resurrection comes in. John and Tim remind us that Jesus said that he was a seed of God's life that would die in the ground, but then grow into a plant that would bear much fruit. And now this new tree of life stands before us all. We can eat from it, but it will mean passing through death like Jesus, allowing our old way of being human to die. Jesus said that he is the vine, and we are his branches. So not only do you eat from this tree, you're invited to become part of it, helping produce its fruit, so that his life and love can spread through us to others. Isn't that a really beautiful way of putting it? I had never made the connection between the tree of life and the Garden of Eden, and Jesus is saying that he is the vine and we are the branches. Which is why in the study guide they claim it should come as no surprise that Jesus' most decisive actions and teachings involve tree imagery. Does that make better sense now? In a study guide, they quote biblical archaeologist Rainer Riesner, who postulates that Golgotha was a rock formation that took shape as a result of quarrying activity. It rose as high as 12 meters and owed its name, Golgotha, meaning the skull, to its shape. And so John and Tim assert that the gospel authors want us to see Jesus carrying a man-made tree to the top of a man-made hill. You get it? Instead of taking from the healing fruit of the God-given tree of life, we not only choose to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, but to chop down that tree, killing it and making it into a cross, so that we can crucify the source of life, the true tree of life, on a man-made hill shaped like death. Fast forward to the end of the Bible, to another book attributed to our patron, St. John the Evangelist, the book of Revelation. The authors of the study guide write, following Jesus means eating from the tree of life now, to a degree. However, John points to the future, complete experience of eating from the tree of life in the new Eden. Jesus himself hints at this truth, saying that the kingdom of God is here, but it's small, like a mustard seed for now. The rest of the book of Revelation reveals how Jesus' followers should live in this now and not yet reality. As they say, in the epic conclusion of the Bible, see how hipster they are, we see a picture of the renewed heavens and earth tying together all the tree imagery that's come before. So to recap, humanity travels away from the tree of life, eating from a tree that leads only to death. And when confronted with the very incarnation of the tree of life that the good tree in the Garden of Eden represents, we kill him on a tree of our own devising. But the resurrection makes it possible for us to share in the fruits of the Spirit. As Paul puts it in Galatians, these fruits are love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faith, gentleness, and self-control. In other words, all the things that we threw away when we decided to eat of the fruit of the other tree, the tree that we thought would bring us power and control, but which has always led only to broken relationships, violence, and death. The problem is, we live in that already not yet reality between Jesus' ascension and his coming again in glory. Why won't Jesus hurry up? Well, Peter, in his epistle, addresses that question by saying that it's out of forbearance, not neglect, that Jesus tarries. But whatever the reason, many people still think that the other tree will bring them power and control. And even those of us who do ingest God's own life, the fruit of the resurrection, the Eucharist, we still often act like we can take power and control for ourselves. We still throw away those fruits of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faith, gentleness, and self-control. So while the meal transforms the one who eats it, and while Jesus is the tree of life, the vine who invites us to become his branches and bear fruit that leads to eternal life, our salvation, while secured, has not yet been fully obtained. This is why in his first epistle, our patron John writes, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone that loveth is born of God, and knoweth God. He that loveth not, knoweth not God, for God is love." It's why we constantly have to ask God to forgive us our trespasses, and to give us the grace to love each other as God in Christ Jesus loved us. And this is why we come here, whether virtually or in person, to this temple of God's love, where at the very highest point of this temple, we find the fruit of the tree of life himself and are invited to partake of him, to ingest his own life, to renew ourselves and offer new life to others in Jesus' name. And so while I really wish we were already at the end of time and Christ was already all in all, as he has promised he someday will be, I know that we can't just stand around caught up in wishful thinking. We all have to live in the love of God, A love that will plant more and more seeds until maybe, someday, in God's good time, the earth is full of the fruit of the tree of life. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. thanksgiving for all the blessings of this life, especially for the birthdays this week of Jane Yonderland and Jane Topham, John Sawicki, Pearl Earl, Reginald Nally Jr., and Rachel Randall, of all those for whom we offer our thanksgivings now, silently. Michael, Stephanie, Will, Douglas Allen, Paul and Elizabeth Model, William Bacchus, Joanne Lozinski, Carl Barrow, Bruno Leach, Warren Boyer, Daniel Benton, Nancy Brewer, John Brooks, Kathleen Sullivan Buck, Bill DiCamacho, Elliot Carter, Ann Close, Jeff Coulter, Wendy Pisotti, Mike and Nancy Curry, Roseanne Curry, Liz Davis, Carolyn Davis, Clint Dempsey, Pamela Dolan, Patrick Fagan, Richard Funk, Joan Garrison, Sherry Good, Charles Gonkowski, David Humphrey, Marilyn Hyder, Ruth Kiker, Doris Lee, Christine Luciano, Rosalie Mazur, Trish Miller, Sherry Moe, Mary Naylor, Heather O'Connor, Maria Octaviano, Gert Padmore, Kim Potter, Joseph Regabuto, Rita Rogers, Raymond Gore, Beatriz Diaz-Sanz, and Ron Vera, John Sawicki, Rita Scott, John Silver, Emmett Shaw, Donald Smith, Daniel Valley, Gloria, Irene Weston, Lily Jasmine Dressel, parents, Robert and Brooke, and for the Sisters of the Holy Nativity, Abigail, Clarice, and Ellen, for all those affected by the coronavirus pandemic, for all those who are being paid now, I pray for the repose of the souls of the recently departed, and for those whose mind falls this week, especially Morton Jaffe, Ellen Rain, and in 1899, founder of St. John's, Peter Clark, Ronnie Steinhaus, and Maureen Panera, the departed members of the Guild of All Souls, departed Sisters and Associates of the Holy Nativity, for all those who died in the coronavirus pandemic, for those killed recently in the stampede in Israel, and those dead from the pandemic in India and South America, especially Brazil, for all those who died of gun violence and brutality, for all those who remember now, silently or aloud, Paul, Hermes, Paris, Lisa, Lewis, Paul, may their souls and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercies of God, rest in peace.
Amen.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that this, my sacrifice and yours, may be acceptable to God the Father. Source of all goodness.
commandments, fill them with thy blessing, creating them to rejoice in the splendor of thy radiance. Countless throngs of angels stand before thee to serve thee night and day, and beholding the glory of thy presence, they offer thee unceasing praise. Joining with them and giving voice to every creature under heaven, we praise thee and glorify thy name, saying,
again and again that is call us into covenant with thee, and through the prophets that is teach us to hope for salvation. That is to love the world, O Father, that in the fullness of time, that it send thine only begotten Son to be our Savior. Incarnate by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, he lived as one of us, yet without sin. To the poor he proclaimed the good news of salvation, to prisoners, freedom, to the sorrowful, joy. That thy purpose might be fulfilled, he gave himself up unto death, and rising from the grave, he destroyed death, and made the whole creation new. And that we might live no longer unto ourselves, but unto him who died for us and rose again, he sent the Holy Spirit, his own first gift for those who believe, to complete his work in the world, bringing to fulfillment the sanctification of all. When the hour had come for him to be glorified by thee, his heavenly Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. At supper with them he took bread, and when he had given thanks to thee, he broke it, and gave it to his disciples, and said, Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it, for the remembrance of me.
O Father, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption, recalling Christ's death and his descent among the dead, proclaiming his resurrection and ascension to thy right hand, awaiting his coming in glory, and offering unto thee for the gifts which thou hast given us, this bread and this cup. We praise thee and we bless thee.
We praise thee, we bless thee, we give thanks to thee, and we praise thee, O Lord our God.
We beseech thee, O Lord, thy goodness and mercy, thy Holy Spirit may descend upon us and upon these gifts, sanctifying them and revealing them as holy gifts for thy holy people, the bread of life and the cup of salvation, the body and blood of our Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant that all who share this bread and this cup may become one body and one spirit, a living sacrifice in Christ, to the praise of thy name. Remember, Lord, thy one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, redeemed by the blood of thy Christ. Reveal her unity, guard her faith, and preserve her peace. And grant that we may find our inheritance with the ever-blessed and glorious Virgin Mary, with St. John the Evangelist, our patron, with patriarchs, prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all the saints who found favor with thee in ages past. We praise thee in union with them, and give thee glory through thy Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Through Christ and with Christ, and in God, all honor and glory be unto thee, Almighty God and Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, world without end.
Thank you.
us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank thee. Thou hast not saved to feed us, to merely receive these holy mysteries, with the spiritual food of the most precious God and Father.